We are coming into the second part of chronic inflammation, that is granulomatous inflammation. So, by definition, a granuloma is a circumscribed area containing modified macrophages, that is epithelioid cells. So definition of granuloma is a circumscribed area of tissue reaction where there will be accumulation of modified macrophages known as epithelioid cells. Now, you can say that these epithelioid cells are frustrated macrophages. What are those? What they will do? They will first try to engulf an organism which of, suppose tuberculosis organism, I am giving an example. They will try to engulf the organism, the macrophages, and try to digest it. But the organism is too resistant to digest. So ultimately, they cannot digest it. So they become angry. Yes, there will be indigestion. And as a result of this indigestion, they will liberate different synthetic substances. And those substances, those stimulation substances, will ultimately act over in an autocrine manner. You know there are three manners. Either a endocrine or a autocrine or a intermediate is paracrine. Endocrine means it is liberated here and it will act at a distant side. Paracrine means it is liberated here, it acts over the surrounding cells. And autocrine means it is liberated by a cell and will act over that same cell. So by autocrine manner, these macrophages will lose their phagocytic activity because they have already engulfed something and they cannot digest. So they cannot further take any dose. No, we will not take, we will not eat. We are doing this thing, no? We are skipping meals. Whenever we are taking something heavy in the lunch, we are skipping dinners. So those macrophages, they will not eat. So they will lose their phagocytic activity. But they will not become useless. They will increase their synthetic property. So they will go on synthesizing a lot of cytokines and immunokines and chemokines. So as a result of this, there will be a tissue reaction. So the macrophage, from his point of idea, if it has a living brain, then from his point of idea is that, okay, I cannot digest the bacilli. Very good. But I will contain the bacilli to that local site within a granuloma so that it will not spread outside. But to do this thing, unfortunately, it will liberate also something that will destroy continuously the tissue. So the bacilli, though it is contained in that focus, the destruction will go on. So there will be always continuous tissue damage. Otherwise, if they can contain without tissue damage, tuberculosis will become a harmless disease. You understand my point? So modified macrophages or epithelioid cells are occurring as a result of macrophages not doing their function properly. Those macrophages have ingested something, a bacilli, or something, an inert substance, like a part of a suture material or a silica body, but they cannot digest it. They have tried to digest it and now cannot digest. So they stop taking further load, stop being phagocytic. Rather, what they will do? Then they will release an important cytokines which will try to contain the infection or the substance at a local site. But in the process of doing that containment, they will also liberate some inflammatory mediators that will give rise to chronic inflammation and chronic damage to the organs or tissues. So that is the story of the epithelial cells. So epithelial cells, if anybody will ask you, what is an epithelioid cell? So this is oid, means like, not epithelial, but epithelial like. So it is a modified macrophage which has lost its phagocytic property but has immense synthetic property. So that is an epithelioid cell. And if you see an individual cell under a microscope, that is cytology, they will look like a shoe. So they are elongated cells and with an elongated vesicular nucleus with or without prominent nuclei. So these cells are the major cells of a granulome. Collection of epithelioid cells is a granuloma. Then granuloma can be two major types. Granuloma can be classified into different modes. One is the immune versus foreign body. In immune granuloma, there will be usually T lymphocytic stimulation. So T lymphocytes will change the macrophages, and as a result of this, there will be modified macrophages, epithelioid cells, along with an intense inflammatory cell reaction. And this is usually occurring in case of low grade microbial infections. Whereas a foreign body granuloma is that whenever there will be any inert substance, in that case there will be not very much lymphocytic stimulation. Only the macrophages will convert into epithelioid cells and will try to contain that substance within the center of the granuloma. So there will be less inflammatory cell infiltration and less tissue damage. So this is the difference between foreign body type of granuloma or non-immune or quasi-immune granuloma and the immune granuloma. So in one case, the inciting agent is a foreign body which is relatively inert. In another case, the inciting agent is an infective organism which is usually a microbial, bacteria, virus, fungus, etc. can be. Then soft versus firm. A granuloma, the central part of a granuloma can be necrosed. Whenever it is necrosed, then the field will be soft. So that is known as a soft granuloma. So caseating, usually that type of necrosis is known as caseating necrosis. A particular type of necrosis where the caseation is like that of curd. Curd, the field of curd, it is not, milk is uniform, but curd is not uniform. So cheesy necrosis is like that. So there will be some bits within that necrosis area. So these cheesy necrosis is known as caseation necrosis. Now this caseation necrosis, whenever it is present, the granuloma will become soft. And whenever this caseation necrosis is not present, then the granuloma is mainly formed by the cells and fibrous tissue. So it will become firm. A classical example, tuberculosis is usually a soft granuloma, whereas sarcoidosis usually is a form granule. Then low turnover versus high turnover, again the same thing. In low turnover, there will be less destruction of the cells. That means porphyria type of thing. In high turnover granuloma, there is destruction of the cells as well as new infiltration of the cells. So that is our immune granuloma. The same thing. So in this way, a granuloma can be classified. The next is morphology of granuloma. A granuloma contains different components, but tuberculosis is very much common in our country and also worldwide, and it will produce a classical granuloma. So we describe the granuloma produced by tuberculosis. There will be a central caseation necrosis. So acellular areas will be there. So surrounding this thing, what is the most important cell? Epithelial cells. So epithelial cells will come and will surround that necrosed area. Now in tuberculosis and also in some other cases, this epithelial cells sometimes join together in order to form a typical giant cell. What is a giant cell? A cell which is large in size. It may or may not have multiple nuclei. But in tuberculosis, we are getting a large cell with multiple nuclei, because they are these all these cells have at least one nuclei. So that will come together and will form a multinucleated giant cell. In tuberculosis, the giant cell that is formed, their nucleus is distributed peripherally. Look, not in the center, peripherally. And they are in a horseshoe manner. So this is known as Langerhans giant cell. So this is typical of tuberculosis, but not diagnostic. But whenever in a tissue we are getting this type of Langerhans giant cell, then we must consider about tuberculosis. Then it is a, now what is your idea? Tuberculosis is a bacterial infection, so there will be some, it is an immune granuloma, so there will be also other cells. So which cells will come after macrophages? Plenty of lymphocytes. Epithelial cells are causing continuous tissue damage and chronic inflammation. So what will come in order to repair this thing? Fibrous tissue. So fibrous tissue will be surrounding. So what we are getting? A circumscribed area of tissue reaction where there is collection of modified macrophages. That's all, it is a granuloma. Your definition is that, we started with that definition. What is a granuloma? Circumscribed collection of modified macrophages. So it is granuloma. In addition to that, tuberculosis granuloma contains central caseation necrosis, presence of Langerhans type of giant cells, presence of collar of lymphocytes, and the fibrous tissue. Any granuloma, sometimes few granulomas may not contain all these components, but still it will be called a granuloma if there will be a circumscribed collection of only modified macrophages. Clear? Now we are coming into different types of giant cells. So giant cells, because this is a very favorite question, sometimes come into theory. What are the different types of giant cells that you encounter? So giant cells, by definition, what is definition? Any cell which is not in size. It can be unimplanted, it can be multi-implanted. So first division is, there is some physiological and pathological. That means the giant cells which we read in first year and the giant cells which we read in second year. Isn't it? Physiology and pathology. So, physiological, what are the giant cells? You have learned in anatomy and physiology. Yes, megakaryocytes present in the bone marrow will produce platelet. Yes, osteoclasts. Osteoclastic cells which are present in the bone and will cause resorption of the bone, not bone formation, but destruction. Resorption of the bone. And the third thing, that is read in embryology. So, yes, the chorionic syncytiotrophoblast. Isn't it? Cytotrophoblasts are uniplated. When they are combined together, they will produce syncytiotrophoblast. So, these three are the physiological cells we have read in the first year. And so, this multinucleated megakaryocytes, and then there will be the presence of the osteoclasts and also the syncytiotrophoblasts. So these are physiological giant cells. Now pathological giant cells, now we are coming here. Again, pathological giant cells, they can be divided into two major portions. One is neoplastic, another is non-neoplastic. Neoplastic is a new term, and neoplasm means tumor. Okay, so some giant cells are associated with tumor, some are not associated with tumor. What is the about Langhans giant cell? What is your idea? It is a neoplastic or non-neoplastic? Definitely non-neoplastic. There is no tumor, there is only infection. So Langhans type of giant cell is a multinucleated foreign body, a multinucleated giant cell of non-neoplastic. And there is another important non-neoplastic giant cell which is known as foreign body type of giant cell. Here the nucleus distribution is mainly towards the center. So it is arranged haphazardly, and more nucleus are towards center. Towards the periphery there will be less nucleus. This is known as foreign body type of giant cells. There are also a lot of other giant cells which will come into different types. And these giant cells, typical morphology often helps to identify the type of infective organism. Again, the neoplastic giant cells, can be uninucleated or can be multinucleated. So uninucleated large giant cells are usually neoplastic, not non-neoplastic. So either it is a large cell with a single large nucleus, that is an uninucleated tumor giant cell, or it is a large cell with multiple large or small different size nucleus, that is a multinucleated tumor giant cell. So this is a simplified approach of giant cells. Whenever there will be a short note, you must write definition, then you write the types, then you draw one or two picture, and then finally you write the importance. The importance of giant cell is that it may in some cases help to identify the pathological lesion. Like Langhans type of giant cell, when it is present, they are pointing towards the diagnosis of tuberculosis. Thank you very much.